Dear Heavenly, gracious Father, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus. We thank you for your steadfast love and attributes of mercy, Lord, that you bestow upon us. Lord, have mercy on us, Lord. Write your words on our hearts so that we're able to go out there and proclaim them to others so they can see you in us. We thank you for this class. We thank you for the ability to know. And Lord, we just want to be able to further our education in the kingdom through this also. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Like Jesus in the book.
All right. We were looking at 3:1-13, basically, the end of this, the reputation of their claim that the world had never been judged by God as a whole. And so these people were not expecting the second coming, which is obviously a judgment of the world as a whole. So he goes on to rebuke that in 5-7, that there's kind of universal flood. Then he kind of gets a little bit sidetracked in 6, 7, 8, and 9, because he's refuted their main point, but he can't refute the fact that there's been a delay. So he doesn't really attack the issue that way. He just tries to explain why there's been a delay. And he goes through the main points that God's time perspective is different, verse 8. God is being gracious, verse 9. And then in 10, he just reaffirms that, yes, it is coming, and it will be everything that was promised, but it hasn't arrived yet. And that's kind of where we left off in 10. The day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, the elements will be dissolved in fire, and the earth and everything that's been in it will be disclosed. There's a textual variant at the end of that passage, and it could be either visible or burnt up. And it's only one letter different. It can either be you're at basis high or you're at enough of a problem that they give it a D rating, which means the committee voted and probably it's either split as a 3-2 vote out of the 5 committees. They're not quite sure. Got good support for both of the readings, but most people are going with the will be disclosed reading. He has been talking about the passing away of the heavens, but not of the earth, and the elements will be dissolved with fire. That's everything that stands in between heaven and earth, the elements and the heavens. The layers of reality between heaven and earth are destroyed, and then the earth is sitting out here with nothing in God's view from heaven to earth. It's disclosed. Everything on it, all of its, all the people that need to be judged are clear to his view. All right. So that seems to be where the exegesis of the moment is. Okay. Let's see if there's anything else you want to address. All right. That gets us to the end of his official apology. Now we go on kind of into some exhortation in 3:11 to divide it quite that way, but I like this better. Did I put 3:11-13 in the apology?
You put the refutation is 5-13.
Let's keep it there then, okay. So with verses 11 to 13, is now, how do you respond if the second coming is really coming? He says, since these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be leading lives that are holy and godly, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt in fire? But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. If we're going to have a new heaven and earth, which he's promising here, which is a promise made in several Jewish apocalypses. Let's see, the first Enoch's got that promise. Second apocalypse of Baruch. That's that promise. These are intertestamental books. And Christianity has some. I guess we ought to quote Matthew. You got first Enoch, who needs Matthew? Revelation. Okay. Lots of promises of a new heaven and a new earth. And if that new heaven and new earth is where righteousness is at home, then that's what he's trying to say in verse 11. If that's where it's all going to end up, then what sort of persons ought you to be leading lives of holiness and godliness? You need to be preparing yourself to live in the new heaven and the new earth by being holy. The new heaven and the new earth, that is its characteristic. And citizens of the new heaven and new earth need to be holy and godly. Basically, you're just preparing to be good citizens of the new reality. Once this one is toast. I still hope God saves the Mona Lisa and the Winged Victory and other things. just to this is what my little children, the best they could do. This is their art projects.
This is a
history for great. These are the best that my children could do in school. Now notice 12. Kind of sandwiched between this. Be holy to the new heaven and new earth with holiness and righteousness as its characteristic. In between, if you wait for and hasten the coming of the day of the Lord, you can actually speed up the second coming by behaving yourself. So you can hasten it by, because God won't have to be as merciful as he mentioned in verse 9. He can come because more people have are ready. So you can actually speed it up by your own personal holiness. So, this is an interesting concept. If everybody, I guess, converted tomorrow,
I
maybe
Jesus
can
just...
Yeah, maybe why it's taking us so long. Trying to get people to behave. All right. Behave for the right reasons. Instead of just I want a condo in the new heaven and new earth. Okay. Alright. Then he ends with some final exhortations and we are finished.
Hey.
14 to 18. Exhortation to stability. Be stable in the midst of all of this nonsense. So this is the actual closing of the letter here. Having refuted his opponents, having shown that there is a second coming, having shown that the prophecies are not false, having shown that his opponents are scuzz, he is ready to... Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. So also our beloved brother Paul wrote to you according to the wisdom that was given to him, speaking as he does in all of his letters. There are some things in them hard to understand, which the ignorant and the unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do the other scriptures. You therefore, beloved, since you're forewarned, beware that you are not carried away with the error of the lawless and lose your own stability. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Whoops. And Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And to him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Okay. 14. Another call for holiness. Be found without spot or blemish. At peace with God, at peace with others. So you're going to be able to enter into the new heaven and new earth. So we're back to purity, holiness. No sin whatsoever on your record. Okay. And he says that Paul talked about the same thing, the need to be perfect at the second coming, the need to be without spot or blemish or be left behind. There's a book by that name. and let's see, I had a few passages where Paul kind of gets into that. The idea that we are to be without spot or blemish is places like Ephesians, Philippians, 1:10, 2:15, 1 Thessalonians, which is about the second coming, 5:23, okay, and of course Jude, 24, but Jude's not Paul. But Paul has talked about a similar need to be perfect. To the point where even if you're committing adultery at the moment, Jesus comes back, you just get left. So, hopefully you were. Did that happen in that book?
I
haven't read it.
That happens in your cartoon in the closet.
The what?
That happens in your cartoon in the closet. Church, remember husband and wife making out?
What?
That's supposed to know this thing. All right. I'm not either. All right. No, in the American Dad, Ian, Stan and Francine are making love in the dinner's closet at church when the rapture comes and they get left behind. Everybody else goes. But you have to be really with it to know that. I'm so impressed. All right.
Moving on.
Then Stan works for Jesus.
Yeah, but Jesus took Stan's life.
Well, that's right. He does get a little weird at the end. All right. But now Paul does talk about the same thing in 15:16. And it's interesting. So he is actually putting Paul's letters on the level of Scripture. Than the other scriptures. So this would imply that it's hard to see the Apostle Peter saying Paul's letters, his rivals, are on par with the Old Testament. So we do see Paul's letters equaling Scripture now, which would imply at least one or two generations. A lot of people aren't appreciated in their own time, like artists and others until after they're gone. And also, being very realistic, that Paul has some very obscure passages. They're obscure even to people who speak the same language, native language. It kind of is, actually, yeah. and probably because Paul has that annoying habit of run-on sentences. And use of vague prepositions and things like that. But anyway, that they use and twist to their own destruction. So there's other people out there twisting Paul's doctrine of freedom in Christ, his position on Judaism, so this isn't the first time he says something's done that. But then he goes back to the Testament, he goes back to pretending that he's writing a Testament. You therefore, beloved, since you are forewarned, beware that you're not carried away. That's what a Testament does. This is, again, being a reminder of what the elder of the community wants remembered when he's gone. So, You are forewarned. You can keep reading this. Don't be carried away by the lawless, by lawless people that lose your stability. So the letter is going to function as a constant beacon of what is appropriate. Okay. All right. Thus endeth the reading.
Yay.
Questions, comments? Further allusions to American Dad? Right.
So, quick question on Baruch.
Baruch, oh, okay.
Yeah, is it the same Baruch from like, Jeremiah?
Yeah.
Cool.
But
like, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Because any obscure figure in the Old Testament, Baruch's mentioned, but, you know, there's not a lot of detail. So, you can use him to write Sudanum's book. Yeah, Baruch is one favorite one. There's more than one book by him. Well, his pretender.
Pretender.
Yeah, might be more than one. The Jewish pseudepigrapha has over 200 works. So by Moses, and Solomon, and Baruch, and we call patriarchs, and you know, this is just an endless. Moses wrote a lot of stuff too. Interesting, it's all in Greek and Aramaic, even though they didn't exist at the time. All right. Ready to go on to Hebrews?
Yay.
We can get a good start on Hebrews. And then when we come back, see, Monday, we'll finish Hebrews, and then we can start sociocultural, looking at sociocultural the method, and move forward toward the book of Hebrews, the text of Hebrews, after Easter. We're right on schedule.
So test 2 is just first and second Peter.
Yes.
We did Jean. Yes. Yes.
Yep. It should, the second Peter, you should know what you should answer because the textbook is me and the notes are me. So whatever I say.
The last question.
Yeah.
And then our final exam is like our third test, and that's over Hebrew.
I don't. Is there another exam?
Yes.
Final? Actually,
during
I
finals week.
Did I?
Oh.
It's on Hebrew.
Did I really?
On Hebrew? Oh, yeah. You said it was up for debate because we're doing the social rhetorical thing.
I did.
Yeah.
It's up for debate now. So if you had mentioned the third test, he would not know.
He would
not
know. He would have figured it out by then.
But then the other tests would have more numbers.
Oh, good point, Ruthann. Nick, you want that down.
All right, let's move to the intro of this.